गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल। गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल।
गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
या गुड मॉर्निंग। सो वी वर डिस्कसिंग ऑन दिस कॉन्सेप्ट दैट इज फील्ड ऑफ थिन लीनियर एंटीना इन द प्रीवियस क्लास। सो वी हैव ड्रॉन ऑल दिस फिगर्स एंड वी हैव कंप्लीटेड द डेरिवेशन। ऑल दिस थिंग्स हैज बीन डन and we got the function of the current as I naught sine of this complete term 2 pi by lambda l by 2 plus or minus z e to the power of j omega t minus s by c. We have also discussed about that we are finding out the fields due to thin linear antenna, and we used the equation for h of pi from the previous derivation, and we have simplified it, and we got it as h of pi dh pi is equal to I j sin theta by 2 lambda s dz, and the relationship of e theta and h pi is equal to z, and it is 120 pi. So you got that, and then further on we got d e theta is equal to, then using that relation dh pi into z, we have substituted dh pi, we got this term. These all things we completed in the previous lecture. And we were in the process of integration. We replaced s is equal to r, and where e to the power of term is there, we replaced as r plus r minus z cos theta. So you have seen this equation where the limits range from minus l by 2 to l by 2, the entire term. So once we completed this, we have split the limits, that is minus l by 2 to 0 and 0 to l by 2. So when it is minus l by 2 to 0, it is l by 2 plus z, and when it is 0 to l by 2, it is l by 2 minus z. We had then further replaced the beta, that is 2 pi by lambda, we replaced as beta, as well as omega by c, we replaced as beta. So in the equation above, so we got this equation further. And then we had to do the process of integration. So before that, we know that minus l by 2 to 0, this entire term is same as that of 0 to l by 2 e to the power of minus j beta z cos theta sine beta l by 2 minus z dz. So this all we were knowing it. So once we replace this term with minus 0 to l by 2 term, Then we have got as written here h of pi. So in detail we discussed in the previous class all these things, and then finally we end up with h of pi is equal to j beta t sin theta I divided by 4 pi r integral of 0 to l by 2 cos 2 beta cos 2 cos beta z cos theta sine of this term. So we got this in the form of sin cos A sin B. So 2 cos A sin B, we know the relationship, that is sin A plus B and minus sin A minus B. So using this relationship, we have used 2 cos of A sin B in this form. So we did that in the previous class. So we got all these terms, that is finally then we got the integration 0 to minus 0 to l by 2 sin of beta cos theta minus beta into z plus beta l by 2 minus sin of beta cos plus beta into z minus beta l by 2 dz. So this is what we got it. Now we have to do the integration of sine. So all of you know the integration of sine. So you have to do that integration. When you do the integration of sine, you find that you get minus cos of beta cos theta minus beta into z plus beta l by 2 divided by beta cos theta minus beta, and you have to take the limits from 0 to l by 2. Similarly, you do the other term also, you have to take the limits from 0 to l by 2. So I have rearranged this term. So instead of this minus, I replace those things and on, I rearrange the term. Then I applied the limits 0 to l by 2 for this term. So when I applied the limits, I end up with this equation in this way. And further simplification of this equation, we got 2 beta cos of beta l cos theta by 2 minus beta cos beta l by 2 divided by beta square minus beta square cos theta. So all of you might have completed till here. So the final answer after simplification, we got it as 2 into cos of beta l cos theta divided by 2 minus beta cos of beta l by 2 divided by beta sine square theta. So this is what we got for that integration. Then we have to substitute in the equation for h of phi. So till here we had completed in the previous class substitution of integration term in this equation of h of phi. So where you have to substitute in this equation. So we have h of phi is equal to this term is there, h of phi is equal to j beta cosine I divided by 4 pi r integral of this integral section we have completed. So we need to substitute that integration what you did here in this equation for h of phi. Once you do that, you get h of phi is equal to this term, and we simplified that, and finally we end up with this equation. So from here onwards we will discuss today. So all of you have substituted for h of phi. Have you all substituted for h of phi? You got this equation. Have you all completed till here for h of phi?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So that after substitution of this integration section, you get h of phi is equal to j beta sine theta I divided by 4 pi r into 2 into cos of beta l cos theta divided by 2 minus cos of beta l by 2 divided by beta sine square theta. So we have to do further simplification when we cancel the terms beta sine theta gets cancelled, and so you end up with the ji divided by 2 pi r cos of beta l cos theta divided by 2 minus cos of beta l by 2 divided by sine theta. This is what the final equation you get for h of phi. So this is what the final equation you get for h of phi. So now we are going to use the relationship of e theta, h of phi and z naught. So that is what we are going to do next. So you can make a note of these equations. So final equation you can write for h of phi is equal to ji 2 pi divided by 2 pi r cos of beta l cos theta divided by 2 minus cos of beta l divided by 2 divided by sine theta. Now we are going to use the relationship e theta is equal to h of phi into z. So you know that z can be written as 120 pi, so it can be written as 120 pi h of phi. When you further simplify that, let us substitute. Anyhow, we got h of phi here. So let me substitute this h of phi in this equation. So I am going to substitute here. So let me substitute h of phi here. So I get e theta is equal to 120 pi h of phi you need to substitute. So when you substitute that, you will get 60 I divided by r cos of beta l cos theta divided by 2 minus cos of beta l divided by 2 divided by sine theta. So this is what you are going to get it. So after substitution of h of phi, you will get it as e theta is equal to J60i divided by R cos of beta L cos theta divided by 2 minus cos of beta L by 2 divided by sin theta. So I have not done anything beyond the substitution. So there are, so these are the electric fields and magnetic fields of due to thin linear antenna. So you can see that you got the electric field d theta and you got the magnetic field h of pi. So this electric field d theta and magnetic field h of pi are the fields due to thin linear antenna. So we have understood these things, and now we have to also see further. So rest of the components like E phi, H theta, all those things were considered to be zero in the case of far field. Okay. So you have two components, H of phi and E theta. So we got the corresponding equations for H of phi and E theta in the case of thin linear antenna, the fields due to thin linear antenna. So if we can make a note of these things, then we'll proceed further. So we are almost done with the fourth module. We'll be starting the fifth module. So is that over? Is that completed?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So we will continue further here. So we have seen the fields due to the thin linear antenna. We got the equations H theta and E, H phi and E theta. So as I have discussed before, rest of the components are to be called as zero for the far field. We have already discussed in the previous derivations all those things. So let me just move on further. So the relative field magnitude, so the relative field magnitude can also be defined as E is equal to cos beta L cos theta divided by 2 minus cos of beta L by 2 divided by sin theta. That is called as the relative field magnitude. So let me take now few things, like I am going to consider few things here. For L lambda by 2 dipole, so the first one case I am going to see is for lambda by 2 dipole. Here we are going to take L is equal to lambda by 2. So I am going to substitute L is equal to lambda by 2. So what I will get, beta L by 2 is equal to pi by 2. So when I substitute L is equal to lambda by 2, I am going to take a lambda by 2 dipole and I am going to find it here. When I take lambda by 2 dipole, L will be equal to lambda by 2, and when I substitute beta L by 2, L as lambda by 2, I get as pi by 2. You know the equation of beta also. So we have defined all those things before. So if I go back, you can see all those equations we have seen. So you have studied here, you have defined here beta is 2 pi by lambda, or you can also define it as omega by c. So what you get here is beta L by 2, when you substitute L is equal to lambda by 2, and you can also go for beta 2 pi by lambda. So when you substitute beta is equal to 2 pi by lambda, and also substitute L is equal to lambda by 2, you can see that you get it as beta L by 2 as pi by 2. So where beta L by 2 is there, let us go with pi by 2 there. So the equation will get simplified as E is equal to cos of pi by 2 cos theta divided by sin theta. So by using this equation, by varying the values of theta, for example theta at 0 degree, theta at 270, theta at 90 and theta at 180 degree, all these things when you substitute, you get the values of E. And when you plot the value in this way, you get the graph in this form. So this is what you means you will get the maximum value in 90 degree and 270, and you will get minimum values in 0 and 180. So that is what you are going to get for E for a lambda by 2 dipole. Let us take, if the dipole is a lambda dipole, for a lambda dipole L will be equal to lambda, and beta L by 2 when you do it, it will be pi. Substitute all those things in the equation for this relative field magnitude. So you get the equation as E is equal to cos of pi cos theta plus 1 divided by sin theta. Similarly, you substitute the values of theta as 0, 90, 180 or 270, any value 60, anything you can give for theta. You see that the pattern is going to be in this form. Similarly, you can consider for 3 lambda by 2 dipole, where L is taken as 3 lambda by 2. And when you do the calculation for beta L by 2, it will be 3 pi by 2. Substitute in the above equation here for the relative field, substitute there beta L by 2, you will get it as E is equal to cos of 3 pi by 2 cos theta divided by sin theta. And when you look into the pattern will be in the a multi-directional pattern, so it will be in all the directions. So you can make a note of 3 cases, that is lambda by 2 dipole, lambda dipole and 3 lambda by 2 dipole. You can note down these things. So the vertical plane pattern depends upon the length of the dipole. When the length of means the, you can see that as the length varies, you can see that there is a variation in the pattern as well. So the vertical plane pattern depends upon the length of the dipole. When the length is less than or equal to lambda, the system is bidirectional, and when the length is greater than lambda, it is 4 directional. So that is what you can see in all the 4 directions it is there. So the vertical, the pattern depends on the length of the dipole, and when the length is less than or equal to lambda, the system is bidirectional, and when the length is greater than lambda, it is 4 directional. So you can see that 3 lambda by 2, so it is greater than lambda, so you can see that it is in all the 4 directions. Practically, for maximum directivity, the length should be less than or equal to lambda. So you have to make sure that what you can understand is in the practical case, to get the maximum directivity, you should maintain the length should be less than or equal to lambda. You can make a note of all these things, and then we will move on to the next topic, that is radiation resistance of a lambda by 2 dipole, the last portion of this fourth module. Actually, as per the syllabus, it is fields due to thin linear antenna, but I just wanted you to learn about the radiation resistance of lambda by 2 dipole as well. So it is an extra topic I am going to deal with because as per the syllabus, fourth module is completed, okay? But let me just take you through this portion also, that is radiation resistance of a lambda by 2 dipole. Because this portion has been repeatedly asked, so you can see, since they have been discussing about the radiation resistance of a thin linear antenna, so it can be also discussed. So that's why, not to take a risk, let us discuss upon the radiation resistance of a lambda by 2 dipole as well. So all of you have completed till here. Shall I go with the radiation resistance of a lambda by 2 dipole?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So we have been discussing about the radiation resistance of a short dipole, and we have also discussed about the fields due to short dipole. We have also discussed on fields due to thin linear antenna. Now let us consider a radiation, how to find out the radiation resistance of a lambda by 2 dipole. So to find the radiation resistance, we know that the pointing vector is integrated over a large sphere, so that is what we are going to do, yielding the power radiated, and this power is equated as I naught square divided by root 2 whole square into RR. So we are going to find the radiation resistance by the help of pointing vector, which is integrated over the large sphere, and then we are going to equate it with I naught by root 2 whole square into RR, which we have also done in the case of short dipole, that is the radiation resistance of a short dipole, where RR is called as the radiation resistance, which you have been studying from 2 to 3 classes before as well. In third module also you have studied the radiation resistance is RR. The current maximum point is, so at the current maximum point, I naught is the peak value in time, and the current at this point, so the total power, you know that the equation for power, the total power radiated is given in terms of H of phi for a short dipole, and modulus of H of phi is absolute value, mod H of phi you call it as the absolute value, and then you have modulus of J I naught is equal to I naught. So by using all these things, we are going to just use the power theorem, and we are going to simplify that as we have done in the case of radiation resistance of a short dipole. So we can say that SR is written, you have already written this before as well. SR is equal to 1 by 2 real part of E theta H phi conjugate. So you can make a note of all these things, then we will discuss further. It's a small derivation to find the radiation resistance of a lambda by 2 dipole. So you can make a note of these points. And we are going to deal with the equation, that is SR is equal to 1 by 2 real part of E theta H phi conjugate. So let me proceed further. So here we are discussing about the radiation resistance of a lambda by 2 dipole, where you are going to equate the power with I naught by root 2 whole square into RR. RR is called as the radiation resistance, and I naught is the peak value of current, and you have the total power radiated, for in terms of h of phi, and that is for the short dipole, and we can say that modulus of h of phi is the absolute value, and you can also say that modulus of j I naught can be written as I naught, and we are now going to take SR. SR is 1 by 2 real part of E theta H phi conjugate, which we have already discussed in the previous derivations as well. So we have quite a lot of relationships here with respect to E theta. We know that E theta is equal to H of phi into Z. So H of phi into Z, we can write it as E theta, and Z can also be written as root of nu by epsilon. So I am just going to use all these relationships for E theta. E theta can be written as H of phi root of nu by epsilon, which we have already done in the previous derivation as well in the same way. So now after doing this for E theta, we got it as H of phi root of nu by epsilon. We can substitute in the equation of SR. So we get 1 by 2 real part of H of phi root of mu epsilon into H of phi conjugate you will get. So I have done that. I have just substituted it. So whatever E theta I got, I have substituted in the equation for SR. So what I get, SR is equal to 1 by 2 real Z H of theta, H of phi conjugate. So you know that the H of phi into H of phi conjugate is same as modulus of H of phi square. So we have replaced that, and rest of the terms is 1 by 2 H of phi square, modulus of H of phi square into real part of Z. So Z, you know that it is root of mu by epsilon. So finally you will get the equation in this form, that is SR is equal to modulus of H of phi square into root of mu by epsilon. So once you complete it, you can just complete these things. So we can use the power equation for power, that is integral of SR into DS. We have been using it from quite a long time. So power is integral of SR DS, substitute SR here. So I can write the common terms or constants, I can take it outside. 1 by 2 root of mu by epsilon, I took it outside from the integration. Rest of the things are there, that is integral of SR DS, no? So that gets converted as 1 by 2 root of mu by epsilon integral of H of phi square mod H of phi square DS, because we have SR is equal to 1 by 2 H of phi square root of mu by epsilon. So do the substitutions. So you will get this. After that we have to integrate this thing. So we will do that. You can make a note of these equations. Is that completed?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So we got the power equation for power, that is integral of double integral of SR DS, and we substituted SR here, and we got 1 by 2 root of mu by epsilon integral of H of phi square DS. So let us continue further. So we need to do the integration for this. Already we know the equation for H of phi. We have already studied the equation for H of phi before itself. So that equation we can use it here, and we have to do the integration process again. Okay, so let us go to the next portion. So H of phi, we have H of phi is equal to, just now we have completed this derivation, that is H of phi is equal to this equation, that is J I naught divided by 2 pi r cos of beta L cos theta divided by 2 minus cos of beta L by 2 divided by sin theta. So just before this topic, we have completed the equation for h of I. So use that equation, take square of that, modulus and square of that. So you can say that when you take the square of this, I naught square 4 pi square r square cos of beta L cos theta divided by 2 minus cos of beta L by 2 divided by sin theta whole square. So this is what you will get it. Now power. Power means you have to integrate the entire thing. That is, in the previous you have seen that power is integral of h of I square ds. So that is what we need to substitute and integrate it. So let us first substitute it. So when I substitute this, I get 0 to 2 pi, 0 to pi cos of beta L cos theta divided by 2 minus cos of beta L by 2 divided by sin theta whole square multiplied by what is there ds you are having h of phi square into ds. So what is ds? Ds is r square sin theta d theta d phi. So that is what you will get it. I'll cancel the terms whichever is common, and pi gets cancelled, 120 into 2 and 120 and 4, all these things get cancelled. Finally, you get it here, 15 I naught square divided by pi. So 0 to 2 pi and 0 to pi, that is phi ranges from 0 to 2 pi and theta ranges from 0 to pi. Cos of beta L cos theta divided by 2 minus cos beta L by 2 whole square divided by sin theta d phi. So integral of 0 to 2 pi d phi. So you know that integral of 0 to 2 pi d phi, you can take it, and when you substitute, when you simplify that, you will get 30 I naught square, integral of 0 to pi, this entire term. This is with respect to theta. So integral of 0 to 2 pi d phi, you will get it as 2 pi. And when you take it outside, this 15 will be converted to 30 and pi gets cancelled. So 30 I naught square integral of 0 to pi cos of beta L cos theta divided by 2 minus cos of beta L by 2 whole square divided by sin theta d theta. So this portion we have to integrate it for the limit 0 to pi. So complete it till here, then we will proceed further. So you'll get P is equal to 30 I naught square integral of 0 to pi cos of beta L cos theta divided by 2 minus cos of beta L by 2 whole square divided by sin theta into d theta. So that is what you get it here. And further on, if you look into that power, so the power we have, that power P is equal to I naught square RR divided by 2. That is a non-equation for power. So we'll get P is equal to I naught square RR divided by 2. Now we have P is equal to this equation also. So we have two equations for P. P is equal to 30 I naught square integral of 0 to pi, this entire term, as well as P is equal to I naught square RR divided by 2. So since both the equations are in power, so we can equate each other. So we can write it as I naught square RR divided by 2 is equal to 30 pi I naught square integral of 0 to pi, this entire term d theta. So that is what we can do. So we are going to equate both the powers. So have you all completed till here?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So let us equate both the things. So you can both equations for power. So you can write that term there. So what from this, what we can write? I have written I naught square RR divided by 2 is equal to this entire term. So from this we can write RR is equal to, you can just rearrange these things. I naught gets cancelled with each other and I naught square gets cancelled, and you have RR is equal to 60 integral of rest of the terms. So 60 integral of 0 to pi cos of beta L cos theta divided by 2 minus cos of beta L by 2 whole square divided by sin theta d theta. So we need to do the integration for this entire portion. So you can make a note of these things. So we are going to take this, we are in the heading itself, it is there for lambda by 2 dipole. So what does that indicate? Radiation resistance of a lambda by 2 dipole means we are going to consider length of that. Length L is equal to lambda by 2. So I am going to consider L is equal to lambda by 2. So beta L by 2 will be, when I do the calculation, I will get it as pi by 2. So wherever beta L by 2 is there, I am going to replace as pi by 2. So I will get cos of pi by 2 cos theta minus cos of pi by 2 whole square divided by sin theta. So this is what you get it. So RR is equal to 60 into integral of 0 to pi cos square pi by 2 cos theta, you will get divided by sin theta. When you simplify this term. Now we need to do the integration for this section, that is 0 to pi cos square pi by 2 cos theta divided by sin theta into d theta. So there is a lot of complication in this integration. It takes almost one complete steps. You have to take all those terms and then simplify that. So once we do the integration for 0 to pi cos square pi by 2 cos theta divided by sin theta, when you do this integration, you will end up with this answer, that is 1.218. So when you do the entire integration, you will get 1.218. So we will get 60 multiplied by 1.218. And we will get it as RR is equal to 73.08 ohm. So the radiation resistance what we obtain here, after the entire calculation, you will get it as 73.08 ohm. So from that, what you can understand is, when you take the radiation resistance of a lambda by 2 dipole, it will be 73.08 ohm. So that is all about the radiation resistance of a lambda by 2 dipole. So you can just complete all the steps. Have you all completed? Okay, 1 minute. I'll wait for a minute. So So you can complete all this portion. And what we understand here, when we take h of I and integrate it for p and then equate the powers, we can find out the radiation resistance. And when you find out the radiation resistance of a lambda by 2 dipole, it is 73.08 ohm. So we have already discussed in this module that is electric dipoles and thin linear antenna. What do you mean by a thin linear antenna? What do you mean by a short dipole? We also studied the radiation resistance of a short dipole. We also discussed the far field field due to the thin linear antenna. We have seen that the component h of phi and e theta are available. Rest of the components are considered to be zero. So all those equations we have found, and we got the equations for h of phi as well as we got the equations for e theta. And we found that all this fields, we have found the fields of a thin linear antenna. After completing that, we also got the equations for the fields of a thin linear antenna, that is h of I as well as e theta. After completing that, we have done with the radiation resistance of a lambda by 2 dipole, where after substitution by using the power and all integral of SR, when you do it, you substituted h of I, everything, and you did the calculations further. And when you completed for a lambda by 2 dipole, you understood that radiation resistance of a lambda by 2 dipole is 73.08 ohm. Okay, so that is what that is all about this module. That is the fourth module. We have completed the module 4 and we can just move ahead with the module 5. So everyone has completed this. All of you have completed?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So it's clear for everyone. All those concepts is clear, no? You can just go through the steps, write and practice the derivations. It's clear for everyone, whatever we have discussed. See, all the derivations are clear for you. See, do you have any doubts or it's clear for all of you? See, all the derivations are clear for you?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so we have completed with module 4. Now we are going to start with module 5. In module 5, we are going to see that we are going to discuss upon, so you can just note down module 5, loop, slot, and patch and horn antenna. So we are going to discuss about all these different types of antenna, you can say. In module 5, it basically depends upon the types of antenna. So what are the different types of antenna, like you will be studying Yagi antenna, loop antenna, patch antenna, horn antenna, or you can say that parabolic antenna. There are lot many types of antennas. So in module 5, we are going to discuss upon different types of antennas. So just to start with, here we have loop antenna, slot and patch and horn antenna. We have few experiments in labs also based on dipole and Yagi antenna, and we also will study helical antenna. So the main objectives of this module is 5. The module 5, the main objectives is to just take you through the different types of antennas and make you familiarized with the design process of each and every antenna. And what so you can see that various antennas can be used in different applications. For example, you have before previous and all you used to, you might have seen, you are using parabolic antenna, you are using Yagi Uda antenna. So all those things, so you might have seen that Yagi antenna on top of your rooftop where you might have even your childhood, nowadays it is not quite common. So you might have seen Yagi antenna to receive the television signals and all. So we were using Yagi antenna there. And you might have also seen dish antennas. Now it's very much common. If you get an opportunity, you can see here and there. There are a lot many antennas based on when you're doing some project, you'll be using some helical antennas, all those things. So it's very much important that to receive and transmit so much of power, what is the design process you have to come across, and how to design an antenna, and how to what are the major terms and equations what you have to consider while the design process, and all those things we'll be discussing in this module 5. So here we'll be studying on loop, slot, and patch and horn antenna. So just to start with, you can say that first one is a loop antenna. So you can just write down the module 5 and loop antenna. So loop antenna is what you can say is it's a radiating coil of cross section of one or more turns carrying the radio frequency current. So this is what we call it as a loop antenna, and we'll be having different types like a circular loop, then triangular loop, as well as square type of loop. So all these things we'll be discussing further in the upcoming classes, where we'll see that how these loop antennas can be designed and what are the relevant equations with respect to this. So you can just make a note of it, module 5, loop, slot, patch and horn antenna. So all of you write down module 5, loop, slot, patch and horn antenna. So first one we'll discuss upon the loop antenna. So loop antenna is a radiating coil of cross section of one or more turns carrying radio frequency current. So you are going to either transmit the signal or you are going to receive the signal. So both the cases you need an antenna to be designed. So you are going to use the you can use different types of antennas here. So a loop antenna is a closed loop antenna. When you talk about it, is a closed path fed by a transmission line or coaxial cable. They are of any shape, like triangular, square, circular. So this is just a brief introduction about this. From here on, we will continue in the next class. So we'll stop it for today. You can just note down few things here, and I'll get back to you with module 5 again in the next class, where we'll be discussing about the loop antenna. Then we'll go on to the discussion about the rest of the antennas. Okay, so that's all for today from my side. Thank you.